Yeah, I did it before, so might as well.
Do you want to use this?
Metallica. I want like. Gonna get you too. Another one bites the dust.
Another one busts the dust. Ow! Another one busts the dust. Hey, hey! Another one busts the dust.
Man, a lot of people come at me like, Drupal's not WordPress, Drupal's not Joomla. Just like, you're right, it's not. Now keep it moving.
Every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling. Every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling.
Where them forms you getting fappy with? I'm the fappy boss. Hooking into edit forms and web forms is my specialty sauce. I hook form alter by form IDs of entities. Put a list on Ajax just to keep it calling back. I got them distributions, I'm like Acquia. Please check my public repos, I didn't copy nothing. I know Dreesen Webchick, I know Ryan Schramm. And all the commerce guys, we hip chat when they got some drama. Might not be pretty cold, but it gets me paid. I'm using rules like PHP looping through arrays. I put it all in features so the code is stable. It might take long, but next time I just click enable. These dudes clearing caches on every hook in it. Queries by the thousands, page load by the minutes.
Every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling.
The language, we compress it hard. Drush CCR, we just drush CCR. Where's all of the changes that you never saw? Drush CCR, we just drush CCR. I lean heavy on Smacks, Cup is compiling my sass. You just install Flex Slider, now you teaching a class. I seen your content types, I don't need to know you to know that we ain't even in the same mode queue. I'm on Drupal answers, check my reputation. I'm on my tablet earning karma while I'm on vacation. Your girl like a module, cause she stay hooking. You couldn't code an info file without looking in. More scrums, better sprints, break the huddle, and the work begins.
Every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling, every day I'm Drupaling.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes. We're at DrupalCon in person. And, you know, some people, I guess, are online. Hey, everybody.
Has everybody learned something exciting in this DrupalCon? Yeah.
No.
No.
Yeah. What are we doing today, Larry?
So first, we are going to do some intros. We're going to introduce ourselves. We're going to talk about some problems that we are having with Drupal 10. Maybe some of you might be familiar with some of those. Then we're gonna talk about some of the new stuff that we are introducing in Drupal 10, like Starterkit, some new default styling that doesn't suck, like the current default styling, some new Twig features, and we're gonna talk about some Drupal WTFs that we've solved and also a couple that we are planning to leave around for everyone to enjoy.
Yeah, we're not solving all those. And afterwards, I want y'all to like think of questions to ask us, you know, or something to heckle us, you know. So introduce yourself.
I'm Lauri Eskola. I'm a staff software engineer at Acquia. I am also a Drupal front-end framework manager. So, yeah, I'm open for questions if you have any.
I am Mike Herschel. I'm a senior front-end developer at AVB Digital. I live in Gainesville, Florida. I like hammocks, dogs, hiking, fast websites. I also want to thank Pantheon. They helped sponsor me to be here.
Yeah. So the problem that we're talking about today is that creating Drupal teams is hard. Does anyone agree with that?
There's like one person in the back, you know?
Oh, I guess we can just create it because of like, it's not hard. Okay, but yeah, so it requires a lot of specific knowledge. And I guess everyone in this room just happens to have that. So that's great.
All right. So the starting point for doing a new theme is kind of weird. Who has their own like little starter file for creating a new theme? A couple more people. It has a complex render system. It has those Drupal WTFs like we talked about. And so if you're a new front-end developer and you come in to Drupal, what you're hoping to do, you're someone's creating a design, you want to write HTML, you want to write your styles, you want to write any type of interaction, but this is really what happens here. Yeah, so for all of you who cannot see this, this is like a 16-step process on how to enable. You have to enable Twig debug. You have to find the right template. You have to ask friends for help. You have to write CSS. You have to copy a template from the system module. You have to figure out your build system. You have to fix IE11 if you're supporting that. There's so much stuff, and it makes you feel like this at the end. Does anybody watch the IT Crowd? It's awesome. Yeah, if you don't watch that, you should. And so we're going to write some documentation.
Does everyone agree with this, that this is how writing Drupal teams is?
Yeah. So I actually created this. This is a picture I took earlier. This is the torture chamber up in the castle, by the way. So, yeah. So this is currently how we do it, right? So talk about Starterkit.
Yeah, so you might have heard of the Starterkit theme generator a couple times in the Dries note and in other sessions. So what is the Starterkit thing? It is a command line tool which you can use for generating themes from themes that are explicitly marked as Starterkit themes. Drupal ships with one Starterkit theme, but it's also possible for contributor modules to ship with additional Starterkit themes. And this is how it looks like when you create a new theme in Drupal.
Hopefully you'll type faster than me, though.
It's still faster to create a theme even if you type slow with this.
Yeah. And look at that. You say generate theme.
Did you use one finger for typing this?
And then you got to name it. And then boom. You got a new theme. That's right? Yeah, this is pretty cool.
You did it, Mike.
I did it very quickly.
Yeah, so why is the Starterkit theme, what is the problem that it's solving? So Classy was the base theme that everyone used to use with Drupal 8 and Drupal 9. That hasn't really seen any improvements since Drupal 8 because of we've had to support backwards compatibility for Classy to not break existing themes that are extending it. So basically, we are trying to enable faster innovation in core. And to be able to do that, we've moved a big part of the maintenance from the core maintainers to the individual theme maintainers. It also provides a better onboarding experience because of... it provides a better onboarding experience because of... instead of having like a blank slate where you start from, you have actually a bunch of stuff in your team already when you're starting. And those are generated by the Starterkit theme generator.
So this is a Starterkit theme right now. It's pretty butt ugly. It's based off of Classy. It doesn't have very much styling. And to tell you the truth, like to get to a point where you have a decently looking theme is still a fair amount of work. So we're going to make some changes to this. And so one of the things that I'm really, really happy with the new Olivero theme is I'm really, really excited about the navigation system. I wrote this cool article on Smashing Magazine that I'm trying to like hype Drupal and everything like that. And so the navigation system with an Olivero is has drop-downs, has second-level navigation. It's very accessible. It has a whole bunch of testing. We did testing with the National Federation of the Blind and all types of cool stuff. But not everybody's going to use Olivero. You know, everybody's going to be creating new themes, and we want to enable them to kind of start with a nice starting place that has accessible menus, and then just be able to style it to fit their theme. And we want to do the same thing for things like tabs or messages.
How many times have you seen a beautiful Drupal theme, but with like completely undesigned tabs or messages?
Yeah, like, it happens.
Yeah, so we want to change that.
As a front-end developer, I don't think about styling tabs or messages or anything like that. And then there's like the toolbar when you preview content. You know, everybody forgets to style that. There's things like a pager. You have to, the pager takes a good amount to style. You shouldn't have to like really think about that. And then what is documentation? Like, are we, you know, in Drupal world, like we don't have enough of it. We want to put that in the theme so people can see it. So live demo here for the, I've been doing some work on the menu system in Starterkit. So let's see if I can pull that up right here. How do I pull?
Maybe you have to change the mirroring so you can see it from here.
Yeah, but then we're going to mess everything up. Give me just 1 second. All right. So I'm going to go to... So while this preview is starting up, thank you to Tugboat. Tugboat does a lot of hosting for our demos and things. So this, of course, is still based on Starterkit right here. Where's my mouse? But it has menus. So it's still ugly, but at the same time, like, this is super accessible, believe it or not. You can tab through, you can go to the chevrons, tab down. Of course, it's very mobile friendly. It has things like a focus trap and expanding, collapsing. All you really need to do at this point is just apply colors and apply like the overall theme. And as a front-end developer, I spend days and weeks on menu systems. They're complicated. And if we can save people's time, that will reduce Drupal's cost overall. And that to me is like pretty awesome. All right.
Yeah, this is all based on the stuff that Mike has been talking on Smashing Magazine and CSS Tricks, which is awesome.
Yeah. All right. So let's get back into this slideshow, maybe. Does that work?
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. So, all right. Thank you.
Let's do this. Now slideshow.
All right. Where do I go here? We're having technical difficulties. There we go. So what else are we doing in the starter kit?
So we want to provide more example code. Examples of that could be Drupal behaviors of JavaScript. Right now, we only ship with CSS and templates. So we want to make it easier for anyone to write JavaScript with Drupal as well when they're building.
Is everybody who here is familiar with Drupal behaviors? How many years from when you became a Drupal front-end developer did it take you to realize that behaviors existed? I'm going to say it's like 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. Yeah, it could be a little confusing.
I've been doing Drupal for like what? I don't know, over 10 years now at this point. And like maybe only after like the last 2 years I've remembered how to write Drupal behaviors on top of my head. Yeah. Took that long to remember.
I still copy and paste. But yeah.
Yeah.
So we want to do SAS. We want to be able to, you know, maybe when you generate a new theme, you know, have it write out to SCSS or PostCSS or something like that.
We'd also like to do a remote Starterkit theme download. So right now you need to have a Starterkit theme available locally in your Drupal site. But you don't always need that step. Sometimes it's completely unnecessary because if you just need the Starterkit, it could just pull it from Drupal.org and create a theme.
Yeah, it'd be super cool if I could just like say generate theme and then say something like bootstrap or tailwind or something like that. And it just like magically hooks up to the internet and pulls stuff down and puts it. It'd be cool.
Yeah.
And then of course we want to be able to clone core themes like Olivero or maybe Claro.
Yeah.
So new templating features. This is I'm really excited about this. So as a front-end developer, as a new front-end developer, I have to like if I want to write HTML in my Twig file, and then if I want to see those changes, by default you have to clear the cache. Or you can like modify your development.services.yaml file, edit your settings.local.php, create some cache bins that point to null, point your settings.php to go to your settings.local.php, and there's probably like two or three steps I'm missing, I don't know. And that, like as a new front-end developer coming into Drupal, you're probably thinking to yourself, what the heck am I getting into? Like that's a little bit ridiculous.
Yeah, so this is not in Drupal 10 yet, but we could get this in for Drupal 10.1, so we could use help on this issue if you're interested in this.
Yeah, we want to just check this box, and then you're in theme development mode, and then everything just kind of works the way you would think of it when you're in development mode.
So one of the things that Drupal teamers sort of struggle with is the decision whether to write prepossess functions or not to write those. Sometimes it feels very excessive to write prepossess functions for some very simple render array modifications. Also, front-end developers tend to dislike writing PHP, which sort of often ends into doing interesting things in Twig. But yeah, it's very hard to do those modifications in Twig because Twig doesn't really provide good tools for doing that type of processing in there. So we think that this should be easier.
Should be very much easier.
So the first idea, which we have, and this was contributed by Hawkeye from Lullabot on the Lullabot blog, which is add suggestion filter. What the add suggestion filter would allow you to do is to add a specific suggestion to a render array. So for example, if you're rendering a field, you could say that I want to render this as a details element, and that would load a field dash details template. And it adds it with a very high priority in the sense that if you have other suggestions there, this would take precedence because of you are sort of on the last minute in the template. That's the last place where you can make modifications. And that way you can ensure that the template gets loaded.
This is pretty cool. Like I can think of so many use cases for this in the projects that I've worked on. Things like when you're like I will render fields as icons, and you want to kind of pass through some accessible names to the icons. All right. along with that, we have some more Twig filters that we want that are going to be really useful altogether. Like you might want to have that add suggestion filter, but add a class to that. You know, so we have these coming down, including add class, remove class, and set attributes, and they do exactly what you think they would do. In this particular example right here, we're adding an attribute called open onto the details field.html.twig, and that will hopefully save a heck of a lot of pre-process or a heck of a lot of funky Twig or a heck of a lot of templating or however everybody wants to do that. Does this sound cool? All right, I see a whole bunch of people saying yeah, a couple people saying no, and something else that I really am excited about is removing unneeded markup. Like the field.html.twig will, of course, wrap your values of the whatever you're outputting in a bunch of divs and or other things. And so we want to create a new value feature. There's a module that does this called Twig Field Value. Who here uses that module? There's like maybe like about 10 people in the audience. And so this is pretty cool. It will output the value.
And then you can put it in elements like Marquee if you want to.
Yeah. And who here has like drilled down into the node, like the node object and done that? You want to tell them why that's bad?
Well, if your backend developers implement field level permission handling, then you're introducing problems.
Yeah,
for them.
You can bypass that. In addition to that, I think there's issues with caching and other things like that.
Yeah, if there's caching added for the field, those could be bypassed as well because you're just accessing the value directly. But all of that we can figure out now that we have a filter for it. We can take that into account and give you the value as a result of that.
In addition to that, this is going to be a lot easier. Like y'all have seen like node.this.that.entity.this.that. You don't want that in your markup. That's a little bit difficult. So we have this issue right here that John Elbin had been working on. And this is kind of a Drupal WTF that I just want to call attention to, and we need help on testing this. And this is, if you all have tried to like do, if you all have tried to override your views Twig templates, and you look into markup to see what template suggestions are available, you're going to see that the views templates are not listed there. So like you should see views-view --unformatted --your-view-name.html.twig. That doesn't get outputted right here. And that's like really confusing. Like why, you know? So we want to fix that.
Yeah, it's really confusing when you don't remember that that bug existed and then you're just wondering like, why are my templates not here?
Yeah, so this is something that's being worked on, and we're working really hard. So who here has used the dump function within Twig? Who here has got a white screen to death from the dump function in Twig?
almost everyone for both, I think.
Yeah.
It's pretty impressive.
So and then so you might try things like Kint. Who here uses Kint? A couple. But Kint is a multi-step install process. Who here uses Xdebug? Xdebug is pretty powerful, but once again, it's a pain in the butt to set up. So we're fixing this, or we fix this.
Yeah, so what we're doing is we are overriding the Twig built-in dump function with something that we get from the Symfony debug plugin. And we did some testing on that, and I was able to print almost any variables from any template. Like I was printing the whole page, all of the variables from the page template, and it just worked.
So this is on my local right here. So we're going to do some live coding because live coding always goes really well. So this is my local. This is the node.teaser.html.twig. It's exactly what you think it is. It's in Olivero. And what I'm going to do right here is I'm just going to type in dump. And
so what this does, it prints all of the variables that are available in that template and their contents.
So if you do this in Drupal 9.4, what's going to happen? It's going to like blow up, your computer's going to blow up. But in Drupal 9.5, all right, wait for it. Everybody sit down. Did I save it? I tested this earlier. It should work. am I in the right repo here? Did I change things around? Oh, I'm in the wrong one. Hold on one second. I'm in the wrong repo. Olivero, Tugboat 10. There we go. I need to do this one. Sorry, I was completely in there. Sorry to scare you there. Now who thinks it's going to work? Whoa, look at that. And check it out, you can expand it, you can go down, so we can find the node object in here that you shouldn't be really drilling down into anyway, and just kind of seeing stuff. And it's exactly what you think it does, and it doesn't blow everything up. It's awesome. Like this is how we expect Drupal to work. So yeah, everything else will obviously still work, but this is in Drupal 9.5.
So that's a massive Drupal WTF solved there.
Yeah.
So one of the interesting things that we've been wondering as we've been talking about like debugging templates is how do people find where CSS and JavaScript is coming from and why is it loaded? And I don't know. I guess we haven't figured that out. So we are trying to...
I just searched the whole code base.
Yeah. So something that we've been talking about within the sort of people involved in the Drupal front end is single file components, which is a popular concept in the JavaScript ecosystem. And it's based on the idea that the separation of concerns should not equal the separation of file types, which is the exact separation of concerns we have in Drupal, where you have CSS in one directory, JavaScript in one directory, and then you have markup in one directory, and everything is sort of disconnected from other. The idea is that if you are working on, for example, the cart component, you are probably editing the markup, CSS, and JavaScript related to that specific component at once, rather than having like one person editing CSS in one directory and then going editing templates, and another person going editing templates in another directory. So this is a major like maintainability and discoverability problem that we have in Drupal.
And it's about like the front end experience. You know, me as a front end developer, I don't want to have to jump between like four different files when I'm just editing one component, because that's like a pain in the ass.
So what we've sort of agreed on, we would like to do, is that you could allow loading of CSS and JavaScript directly from templates. So that would bypass the mandatory creation of libraries. Because of libraries essentially created the expectation of reusability and backwards compatibility, since they are always explicitly exposing an API from there. What it also does is that CSS and JavaScript are connected to your templates. It makes it easy to understand the relationship between the CSS and JavaScript and markup, because of in your template, you're loading the CSS and JavaScript that is associated to that template directly. So the issue is on the bottom of the slide if you're interested in getting started on that. So here's an example of how that could look like. So we haven't still decided what is the specific method of doing this. This is just one example to give you an idea how this could look like. So we are loading a CSS file and JavaScript file, and this is probably not how it's going to look like in the end.
Other potential ways would be have, like in the same directory, have a JSON file or a YAML file or something like that.
So this is not quite single file components, but it does enable single directory components, which is already a huge step, because of with single file components, you can copy your file and it already does a thing. With this, you can copy a bunch of files to a directory and it does a thing, instead of how it works right now in Drupal, where you have to copy a bunch of files to different directories and then edit your library's YAML file, and then maybe you have something that works.
This is going to be big. I'm excited about this. So modern CSS and core, this is something I'm passionate about. I'm the maintainer and main dev on the Olivero theme. And Drupal's core CSS has some warts, some skeletons. You can see in this is some old Vue's CSS that was probably written while Vue's was still in contrib. And you can see here we're using floats for layout. So if you're a front-end person, typically you should not use floats for layout. And we don't like really need to blame anyone, but if you can see Laurie's name up there, he committed it. but no, it's not his fault. It's what it is, you know. But where do we want to go with this? We want to make these components easy to extend, you know. And we can do that through things like CSS custom properties and modern components. And we have this cool new responsive views grid that I'm super excited about. And we've already started in Drupal 10. Like when the Drupal 10 branch got forked, I immediately started ripping out a bunch of Internet Explorer stuff, and I was so happy. And we're doing a bunch of cool stuff, including a new responsive views grid in views core, settings tray CSS. We're going to talk about this stuff. I'm going to talk about Drupal displace and being able to change the colors and Olivero. And all of this is based off of modern CSS. So I'm going to show you the responsive grid in core, because I'm super excited about this. So let's see if I can do this. So
if you're tuned out, now is a good time to pay attention, because this is like one of the most exciting bits of this presentation.
It's pretty cool. All right, and thank you once again for Tugboat for helping. So this is the old CSS right here. I have like, and this is using the Stark theme, because I wanted to kind of demonstrate that it's not using Olivero or anything. And you can look at the old markup right here, and you can see that each row is kind of you know, wrapped in a div, and it makes it impossible for it to be responsive. And if sure enough, if I resize this, it doesn't reflow. So within Drupal 10, which is this is Drupal 10, we have a new grid format called responsive grid. Everybody see that right there? And once you get in here, you have all these options. And instead of asking you at what breakpoint do you want to change the number of columns, it gives you these questions. It says, what's the maximum number of columns? And then what's the minimum amount of the column width that you want? And then how much of a gutter do you want in there? And then it magically, through the magic of CSS, no JavaScript, no PHP, well, maybe in the back, but it just figures it out, and it's so cool. So, like, we're gonna change this to, I don't know, 300 pixels and all that, and it just plain old works. I'm gonna hit save. It'll hopefully redirect me back. So you can see, boom, it just works. It uses CSS grid, and you can see if I go like that, we're going between 3 and 2 columns, and it just fits. It's not dependent on the screen width. This is cool. Every single project that I work on, I rewrite some version of this, and this is going to save me hours of code, and I'm super excited about that. All right, slideshow. Pause for applause once again.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this is all the cool CSS. I'm not gonna explain this, I'm not gonna dissect it, but you can see like there's a whole bunch of custom properties and then calculated custom properties, CSS grid, and some calc in there. And if you wanna look at the CSS, you can see where that lives within the code base.
So something else that we've been working on in Drupal 10 is the off-canvas dialogue. So how many of you have run into problems with off-canvas dialogue and leaking styles in there? Maybe like 15, 20 people?
Yeah.
Not too bad. But it's a huge problem, at least for the core teams. So only from our perspective, it's already a huge time saver in terms of like writing CSS just to fix those problems. So the problem was that we came up with a CSS reset to sort of try to prevent that from happening. But it was not great. And because of it was based on technology that we could use that supports IE11.
Yep.
So this is basically how.
Yeah, we had all these usability and accessibility issues, sorry.
Yeah, and then we wrote specific CSS, for example, in Olivero and Claro, to fix this for Olivero and Claro specifically. So in Drupal 10, what we've done is we have a new CSS reset, which is based on all revert. And we are also using a where selector to make sure that we are not increasing the specificity of this. So basically now, if you want to write styles for the off canvas, what you can do is simply use the Drupal off canvas wrapper selector, the ID, and then any kind of other element or class. And that will be able to override the styles that we are providing. Those will be able to override the reset. On top of that, what we've done is we provide a whole bunch of CSS custom properties so that if you need to redesign the off-canvas, for example, some teams are providing a light version of the off-canvas instead of a dark one, which we provide by default in core. You don't have to overwrite all of the specific details of the CSS. What you can do is just modify the values of these custom properties, and that will be enough to restyle the off-canvas. Basically, when we were working on this, and you did most of the work on that, what you did was that, I mean, by you, I mean Mike. What Mike did was he had a sort of themed version of the off canvas. He overwrote those variables to confirm that he could actually create like another theme version of the off canvas himself.
It's pretty cool. I was, through this change, I was able to delete a whole bunch of code out of Drupal 10. And like as a developer, one of our favorite tasks is deleting old crufty code. And we were able to do this, and so I was super excited.
So we needed to, so that's a sort of busy break. So if you are doing any off-canvas CSS, please review your CSS with Drupal 10. What was cool in core was that I think for us, mostly updating meant that we just removed all of the CSS from the teams.
Yeah, we were able to just, like, Olivero and Claro had a bunch of fixes for our individual themes for the off-canvas dialogue. we just were able to just straight up delete those, which is awesome. So Drupal Displace, who here has heard of Drupal Displace? It's like two or three people. Drupal Displace is an API, it's a JavaScript API. It's been included since, I think, Drupal 8.0, but it's a JavaScript API. You can call Drupal.displace, and it returns the offset of if you have toolbars or an off canvas or something that's poking out from the side, and enables you to position fixed elements against it. You know, so who here, like if you're doing a fixed header, who here has done a fixed header, but then the toolbar covers up part of it? You know, yeah, a bunch of people are raising their hands.
And maybe like 30%, 40%.
Yeah, something good, like good, that.
Yeah.
And so you try to look at the CSS classes, and you say like, all right, well, the CSS class says it needs to be 40 pixels from the top. But what if the toolbar's open? Or what if the toolbar's in like the vertical orientation? And you're trying to figure all that out. Well, now we just have a CSS custom property that does this.
Yeah, no JavaScript involved in this.
Yep, if you use this, it will automatically figure itself out from how far it needs to be from the top of the page. And then, of course, there's corresponding CSS custom properties for each edge. Yeah, thank you. Olivero color changing. So Bartik, of course, you could change the color in Bartik, and it relied on the color module. It was it worked from the end user point of view, but from a developer point of view, how was it?
It was pretty bad.
Yeah. So in Drupal 10, we're using CSS custom properties, and we're using modern CSS, and we can do Olivero color changing. So if you want a beautiful bubblegum pink, you can do that. If you want... Oh yeah, you can see the custom properties that pop up in the HTML tag right there, and it just works. Big shout out to Andy Bloom sitting there who did the majority of work on this. So thank you, Andy. Like this is big in my opinion.
So color module is removed from Drupal 10, and we have sort of an alternative implementation of that in Olivero. So you can still do your color changing with Olivero.
So I snuck the sled in. I don't know if I told you. I am an organizer for Florida Drupal Camp, which is going to be in February in Orlando, and you all are officially invited. And if you have complaints or questions, now's a good time. And John's going to help us out.
There's one question from the app, the live Q&A. It is about core behavior, Drupal behaviors in core. Mm-hmm. And they're asking if the code is written in ES6.
You want to answer this, or you can talk about like the removal.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Oh. So in Drupal 9 and Drupal 8, we had this tool for building JavaScript from ES6 to something that is compatible with Internet Explorer 11. That is removed from Drupal 10 because of we don't support IE11 anymore. We are using ES6 because that's supported by all of our compatible browsers, but we are not doing the compilation step anymore from ES6 to just plain ES5 JavaScript. So it's a much simpler approach that we have in Drupal 10, but basically the JavaScript that you write is still the same.
So the answer is yes. All right, more questions.
Yes, I have one.
Anyone else?
If anyone else has any other questions, no. I can queue behind you.
I'm messing with you. Go ahead, John.
Actually, I was asking about the single file component. In the example, were you using front matter to do that part of the document in Twig?
Yeah, it was using Twig front matter, which we have already in Drupal core, used by help topics, for example.
Come on, more questions.
Or complaints.
Or you can throw something.
I guess I can report back to my manager that there's no complaints from anyone.
Drupal theming is done.
Thank you for a nice presentation, very entertaining. Is it possible to use like the backend styles and off-canvas dialog, you know, when I'm in the front end? Because I feel like, you know, like prefixing everything and then having to change the front end, you know, that's specifically done, you know, but it's not made for editing, you know, but I have Jin, I have Claro, it's really beautiful, works like responsive. Could I use that in the off canvas dialogue?
The answer is heck yeah, because like that is exactly the problem that we were trying to solve to make it easier for Jin or Claro. So all that Jin or Claro, well, Claro's already in core. All that Jin would need to do is just have that library load that could maybe happen through the Jin toolbar module. And then it would be very, very easy for the CSS to load for the settings tray, override, and not have any front-end styles leaking in. So absolutely.
Yeah, so we don't have an API for that specifically in Drupal core itself, but you can load libraries from other teams, and there's nothing preventing from modules doing
but
that.
But I would still need to override. I have styles that I then have
yes,
to override.
Yes, but that could be done by Jin, for example. Claro doesn't provide that functionality, but there could be a Claro off-canvas everywhere module, which loads the Claro off-canvas styles everywhere.
Okay, so yeah,
and it could sense. Load it directly from Claro. It doesn't even have to duplicate the styles. So yeah, it is not supported by core purely by itself, but we are fairly confident that the CSS reset, which we have in place, works well enough that it could work with all these kinds of different use cases that Jin and other teams would have.
Yeah, good idea. That would work. Thanks.
Do you need to update themes that are currently rely on subtheming somehow? You need to remove that, or?
So subtheming exists as a concept. It's not something that we've removed. It's just that we've relied on subtheming very heavily for the life cycle of Drupal 8 and Drupal 9, and we are sort of trying to remove some of that from the experience because of right now, to even do a very basic theme, you have to sort of understand the concept of subtheming. With the concept of Starterkit, you can do quite a lot without even fully understanding how subtheming works. And so classy and stable are being removed from Drupal core, but they are available as contributed projects for teams that are relying on those to continue extending them in future. So I personally don't feel very strongly about existing teams moving into using an approach similar to Starterkit. I think existing teams can continue working as they've been built, but for any future teams, I would recommend going with the Starterkit team-like approach.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I wanted to ask about the definition of scripts and styles in Twig template. So basically in Drupal library is like keeping the quite important power of Drupal, which is possibility to extend, override, and basically hook into many places, many APIs. And for me, that change looks like it's kind of breaking change in that meaning. And wanted to ask, what's your point of view on that, or whether you have some solutions to keep that compatibility?
Yeah, thank you for that's a good question. So we are not completely removing the library system. The idea is to move into using the CSS and JavaScript that is directly loaded from templates in instances where the CSS is very directly tied with specific kind of markup. And then if you want to override the CSS, you would also have to override the markup with the CSS. So you can't, you sort of, there is some amount of extensibility that is removed from there, but we've sort of struggled a lot with the amount of flexibility that we provide right now where CSS and markup and everything can be basically individually overridden because of, then you can't really change the underlying markup or the underlying CSS because of someone might have overridden the other piece on their behalf. So it will make things more consistent, but also things like normalized CSS. It will continue to be a library, and there will be other CSS and JavaScript files that are still in the library's system and can be overridden using it.
Okay, thanks for answer.
If you have more thoughts on that, I think it would be very valuable if you want to chime in on the issue or just let us know on Slack. I'm very happy to chat about this in more detail because of that is a very important consideration when we decide sort of how and where we start utilizing that.
Yeah, I had a question for Lori. In Drupal core, who's about to become the maintainer of the CSS?
Do we know? Does anyone have answers to that? Mike?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, there's an issue. I'm going to join as a core maintainer for the CSS subsystem. So that's the thing, so thank you.
So there's an issue in the Drupal.org issue queue, so if you have any complaints on that, please leave them on the issue.
There's no complaints. Any other questions or complaints or thoughts? Thank you. Let's do one more selfie together. Ready?
That went well?
Yeah, we did pretty good.
Yeah.